So Dalit theology is as protest theology, and therefore it speaks about as a voice of resistance to the colonial projects, particularly trying to learn to listen from the margins. And basically what I have said, doing Dalit theology in a 21st century British context, I think what I've said in red is Dalit theology contests and counters normalizations of any status quo that privilege and sanction oppression and exclusion of any form and every form, and engages in counter epistemological theological praxis, is what I say about Dalit theology. I have it written fully, but this is in crux. So Dalit theology as a protest theology. And then public theology, I quote from Elaine Graham, which is a famous book, Between a Rock and a Hard Place. And as was already touched, the difference between public and private is very thin. I mean, all that is private is not authentic, and all that is public is not authentic, if I have to answer John. So therefore, Elaine Graham says there are three motives of public theology, which is, it is Christian apologetics in presence. It seeks about the welfare of the state or the earth. Then it speaks truth to the power. And it is also an apologetic presence where we need to defend Christian faith in the context of growing secularism, so on and so forth. Thirdly, Lutheran theology as a protest theology, which is to say that, I mean, we need to understand Luther's theology in his own times, and Walter Altman, who continues to say, as you all know, the term Protestant was given as a secular, a derogatory term to the people who were part of this Reformation movement. But however, it is also to speak about the protest, which is to place oneself seeking for a higher value, the virtue or the authenticity or the word and so on and so forth. And therefore, Lutheran theology for me is a protest theology, testing the validity of theology and seeking relevance for theology, situating it in our own times, is how I say. So Dalit theology as protest theology, public theology as pro-public theology, and then Lutheran theology as a protest theology. Then I'm trying to say why we need to move towards a Dalit public Lutheran theology, and I say the Dalit Lutheran theology need to take three turns. Number one, it needs to take a contextual turn, because we need to decenter Lutheran theology from its Eurocentric versions. And there are several things that can keep speaking about it, because Luther and Luther's theology in the two-thirds world has been introduced by the Western missionaries to our early converts. And today, we hardly have any Luther's works in our own languages. We only have to learn German to read Luther, or read it in other places. And therefore, I think there is so much of Eurocentricity within the Lutheran theology, and therefore, we need to move, decenter from this Eurocentricism and move into a contextual turn. And one Indian Lutheran theologian, Prabhakar Dayam, says, to be liberated by God's grace is to be liberated unto God's grace, which is a free expanse of the freedom of love. And therefore, to be confessional is to be contextual, and it is an affirmation of a context and a context. And therefore, Dalit Lutheran public theology has to take a contextual turn. Secondly, it has to take a post-colonial turn, because it has been so much, the epistemology has been so colonial in its times, and which is explained because a simple illustration, my own church, the liturgy that we use in my own Lutheran church is a translation of the German liturgy of the Lutheran church, where in Germany I think they don't no longer use that liturgy, but after 175 years, even till today, we sing the same tunes. And therefore, it's time that we need to move forward because of this colonial episteme that we have in our own Lutheran liturgies. And however, in my own church, again, they moved into the Carnatic musics of the liturgies, which again is a dominant resource, because 99% of my own church comes from Dalit context, and hardly there are any Dalit cultural resources that have been used to be said as a liturgy in my own tones. Therefore, I propose that it needs to take a post-colonial turn. And thirdly, it also needs to take a subaltern turn in terms of locating Lutheran theology in sites of subalternity. Subalternity as a theological site from where Luther and Luther's theology has to be understood, which I will do in a moment in terms of understanding justification by faith. So Lutheran theology, to take subalternity as a theological site, has to move from the self-representations and to listen to the reflections and aspirations. And therefore, this is how I would like to propose that. And then I would like to move towards a Dalit Lutheran public theology, which is to speak about the context, is a critical faith reflection on the contextual challenges of our own times from a Dalit public and Lutheran perspectives. And it is a theology of its times. So therefore, I pick up justification by grace through faith as a Dalit public theological engagement to understand what it is. And in my paper, I have explained justification by grace through faith in Luther's time, how it meant and what it meant. And probably to paraphrase all of that, it is to say that any effort of humanity cannot be there, and it is only God's gracious act through which each of us are saved, which was a revolutionary one in Luther's time in terms of bringing justification by faith through grace as a revolutionary one. But allow me to say a few pointers to understand justification by faith through justification by grace through faith. Firstly, it speaks about a human dignity of all. Justification by faith brings in the prerogative of God and Christ's, because we are saved on God's terms and Christ's terms and not on human terms. And particularly speaking in a context of caste where people are graded in terms of hierarchy, justification, the doctrine helps us to think that we as human beings are created with equal dignity. The second thing I say is justification and karma. And we have, because of our good works, this is where I would like to extend the discussion of Anthony Reddy when he says about works which need to be spoken. But sola fide has to be understood that in Luther's time it was spoken in contrast to sola Roma. And therefore, at his times, which was an important one, but karma is a philosophy which says by your good works, there is a hierarchy that you can achieve, so on and so forth. But justification contradicts that, and we need to move forward. And the third thing, justification also brings us the understanding of a de-transcendental sacred. Sacred is not somewhere, the divine is not somewhere over there, but it is God who finds us. It is not that the sinners become, say, gods, the divine, but it is the divine that chooses to be a sinner and comes to our sight, is how we need to understand in terms of the de-transcendental sacred and understanding of it. And here it is where I would like to see, is the term justification by grace through faith sufficient today? Altman discusses that each context developed a theological key and a concept relevant for their times. And therefore, Altman says for synoptic gospels, the emphasis was on nearing the reign of God. For John, it was revealing the glory of God's Christ. And for Paul, it was justification, reconciliation, which emerged out of their context as the context demand. So Bishop K.H. Ting from China, he says that this justification by faith is insufficient doctrine because he felt there is a growing rift among people in China based on this doctrine. For many left excluded, no matter what their morality is, they are divided as believers and non-believers. So Bishop K.H. Ting thinks that justification by grace by through faith is not relevant in his times, and therefore he seeks we need to move forward. Altman proposes that liberation should be an adequate motive to understand justification. And therefore he says we need to move forward. But again, to speak in my own context of Dalit public theological context, I think justification by faith has certain insufficiencies because justification is a legal term. It is, and in the context of judiciary, it is very casteist, very dominant in our own times. And therefore, there is a call to move towards a liberation after liberation theology, which is what I propose here. And therefore, I propose hospitality by love as an extension of justification by faith. Therefore, in the context of Dalit public sphere, which comes as a counter public sphere, for it counters exclusion and discrimination done in the name of caste, and tries to propose hospitality by love as an extension to justification by faith. This nomenclature supplements to what has been already said, and we need to understand salvation today is understood as hospitality by love, for God in Christ, through Christ, has received everyone into his hospitality by an equal love for all creation. So hospitality is the public theological articulation of justification today, and it becomes both an affirmation and an aspiration. Hospitality by love is revolutionary, is theological, and a contextual necessity of our times. So then I argue how salvific is hospitality, because I use Shauna Songer Gaines, who says her reflections on hospitality and salvation, and she says, the place of salvation is the kingdom of God breaking into creation. God offers salvation not out of our scarcity, which drives the Son to the cross, but from an abundance of love for creation. And I think that makes a distinction of how we understand salvation. I read it back. God offers salvation not out of scarcity, which drives the Son to the cross, but from an abundance of love for creation. Christ's body is the ultimate host, laying claim to nothing, not even life itself, but giving up everything for the sake of the other. The hospitable self is both a recipient of God's gift of salvation, as well as a gift of hospitable selfhood offered back up to God through welcoming the neighbor. When the gift of hospitality is offered, one is freed from being unwelcomed and freed to be welcomed into God's reign. Christ's act on the cross is the ultimate example, for he, in offering hospitality to the creation, has given up everything, including his life, and received everyone with love, and love in abundance without any boundaries. The key points for discussion in hospitality are invitation, reception, boundaries, and space. And in the context of Dalit public sphere, hospitality by love finds its relevance, for those that are born outside of the caste are welcomed and embraced into God's kingdom, for they are welcomed as they are and given space unconditionally. Hospitality by love affirms in God's prerogative, for it is God who invites all people irrespective of their identity into God's household. For God in Christ is welcomes and receives all nations at the throne of his grace. Hospitality by love discounts all meritorious works done by humanity to be invited into God's hospitality. For hospitality by love shows forth unmerited favor and reception to all creatures. Hospitality by love as a Dalit public theological category. Gregerson in his discussion argues that today we don't live in a culture in which Luther lived. And therefore Protestantism, which is governed by its principles, need to take into consideration today's audience, and they are an ensemble of secularization and post-secularity. And therefore the Protestant principles, which were pedagogical in their own context, have become unworldly and dull. And that's the reason we need to move forward from sola scriptura, from sola fide, because they have become unworldly and dull. In order to make them as part of the lived religious experiences, he proposes that faith has to be lived in four E's: the emerging from tradition, environmentally sensitive, socially embedded, and psychosomatically embodied. And therefore, Dalit public Lutheran theology, by proposing hospitality by love as a relevant after justification principle for our times, is trying to articulate Lutheran theology as a public Dalit theological category, for it emerges out of our own local Dalit tradition, for it is environmentally sensitive to the context where hostility among people in the name of caste is growing up, for it is socially embedded in the practice of Dalit communities, and it is embodied in the very ethos of Dalit spirituality. For Dalits, hospitality by love is central to their whole life and ethos, which is built on communitarian values, contesting all forms of individualism and selfishness. For dominant castes, hospitality by love comes as a challenge to practice hospitality unconditionally, for hospitality defeats the notions of purity and pollutions, and hospitality by love contradicts the notions of commodification and commercialization, and supports the idea that salvation is not for sale, human is not for sale and creation is not for sale. In the context of coloniality, the roles of host and guest are fixed, for power operates among such categories, ascribing dominance to host, leaving the guest as mere recipient at the mercy of host. In the Dalit understanding of hospitality, the locations of guest and host are not fixed, and therefore they are fluid, for they are in a constant interchange of roles with an aim of building just and inclusive communities among a people, dismantling all power hierarchies. Understanding the self as hospitable is a way to understand our lives wrapped up in the story of God's salvation. However, it does not allow us to conceive of salvation solely in terms of pardon for an individual soul. If salvation is a divine welcoming, we must look to the whole life, death and resurrection of Christ as our source of life, as did Irenaeus, who rightly saw that Christ recapitulated all that God desires for creation. When we concern ourselves with justice for other, preaching good news to the poor, freeing the prisoner, so on, we are participating in that salvation, and Dalit public Lutheran theology therefore affirms towards that divine welcoming of people into the embrace of God. To summarize, if Protestantism has to have the flesh and blood, which knows that faith and love and hope can only thrive, it is to say that we need to affirm in the equal dignity of all human beings. It is to acknowledge God's prerogative in the project of liberation and salvation. It is to understand God from bottom up, and it is to say that justification by grace needs to move towards hospitality by love. Finally, for us as a community, as faith communities, the relevance for us of Dalit Lutheran public theology is, one, the call is for us as church as a site of hospitality by love, where we are sensitive when we sing all are welcome, or where we need to understand church as a guest. So therefore, Dalit public Lutheran theology finds its relevance in hearing to speech these often neglected or overlooked voices, and calls for hospitality by love as a translation of justification by faith into action and praxis. So the logic of empire is to other those that do not belong to us, and that do not believe like us, and that do not look like us. And in moving towards and contesting the empire, church as a site of hospitality, we need to see that we resist all forms of prejudice, hatred, and division, for church is a place for which belongs to those that does not belong to us, that does not believe like us, and that does not look like us. And if churches can be transformed, I think church as a site of hospitality will have meaning and relevance in that direction. Secondly, subalternity as a Eucharistic point of theological hospitality. The post-colonial shift calls us that we need to shift towards a subaltern point, because it is a space of radical hospitality, a Eucharistic point where kenosis and grace are mutually shared among all the theologies and people participating. So therefore, this space of radical hospitality is where we need to locate insights of subalternity, which is to listen, learning to learn from below, learning to learn from below, which is the Eucharistic site of theological hospitality, which helps us to relook at the ourselves, to deconstruct the self, to revisit the other, and to de-transcendentalize the sacred, and to lose all their theological privilege. That would be a challenge to move forward. And finally, a re-return of religion at the table of public sphere. 2016, the word of the year for 2016 was post-truth. As was already said, those people believe in an evidence but still go to vote for something different. And for 2017, the word of the year is youth quake, which I thought is an important one, because how young people continue to change through the political involvement and motivations. So you can read to it, 2017, the word of the year is youth quake, which is trying to call us to say that faith comes back to the public sphere. Faith is no longer a private matter to be discussed to find out who we are. But I believe the no religion of 50% of the British context is a new phase of the Christian era, the post-Christian era, with which we need to understand. Reformation in my own language is a word which is called matodharana, which means restoration or upliftment. Therefore, I think a re-return of faith to the table of public sphere calls us towards a restoration, an upliftment, a recommitment to at the table in the presence of God. So as a site of hospitality, it calls us towards moving in towards that end. Finally, to conclude, the call after 500 years of Reformation, Archbishop Rowan Williams, when he was writing on the legacy of Reformation, he says, the greatest theologians of Reformation were not zealots seeking to expunge history and symbol from the Christian mind, or individuals committed to the autonomy of private conscience, or theocrats determined to impose on all human society an unreconstructed version of Mosaic law, or rationalists obsessed with words at the expense of both silence and sign, or biblical literalists with a mechanical model of inspiration. 500 years of Reformation calls us to speak truth to the power. The call today is to reject the ugly practice of domination, be it caste in my context or race in other contexts, and therefore calls us to see that the public spaces of church, academy, and society becomes zero tolerant zones against discrimination. For Jesus Christ, it was between Roman Empire or the Kingdom of God, and he chose the latter over the former. For Luther, it was Rome or Christ, and he had to choose Christ over against any other ecclesial authority. In my own context, it is caste or Christ, and the challenge of theology is to choose and seek Christ over against any other thing. And for such a thing is now required in reformation of our churches. Injustice done anywhere affects justice everywhere, and Dalit Public Lutheran Theology strives to that end in addressing issues of injustice at all levels. Thank you very much.